Hi, so I'm Leslie London and I'm a PHM activist here in Cape Town, and we're going to be talking about health systems and equity in health systems. It's a big issue that PHM has taken up over many years, and of course now with COVID we have many other issues to deal with, but health systems really underlie our ability to deal with COVID. So I'm looking forward to this discussion because I think health activists need to get together to deal with these issues. So, yeah, we're going to talk soon.
Hi, everyone. Yeah, my name is Dennis Bukenya, the coordinator of the People's Health Movement in Uganda. Yeah, today I'm excited. I'm going to be having a sit-down chat with Professor Leslie London, and I'm really excited to ask him about so many things.
Hi, Dennis.
Hi, Leslie.
It's fantastic.
It's been quite a while.
From far away. We've been separated for so long.
Yeah. You must have been so busy.
Yeah, it would be great to come back to Uganda now, but with COVID, it's just too bad. I really miss Uganda. Okay.
Yeah, I hope our work somehow will bring you here, or I'll bring me to meet you there in South Africa. I mean,
sure.
Given all this COVID-19 situation and all that saga. Leslie, we met here, I think it was somewhere around 2012. And that was the beginning of my career, because I started out as a lawyer and I really worked a lot in issues with health equity. But then right now I define myself as a lawyer turned health activist. So I think that project we're working on was called Health System Strengthening, using participatory models. And since then I have worked as a health activist in participation, and I have had an insatiable interest in issues to do with health systems weakening through health privatization. Right. And I have done a lot of work around health equity and sustainable development in so many paradigms. So my biggest interest now lies with issues to do with participation too.
I've been a professor at the University of Cape Town for 30 years, actually. But I've always been a human rights activist and been involved with PHM when PHM started. In South Africa, I don't know, 15 years ago. I've been involved in PHM activities since then. I'm particularly interested in participation and how civil society can play a role in health equity. The peak of our epidemic, you know, we thought that we would be able to look after the health system as a whole. You know, that if there was a need for intensive care beds, we could find beds in the private sector, in the public sector, we could manage it as one. But it was never like that. It was always the case that the private sector kept their beds for themselves. If they had any spare beds, they'd sell it, you know, rent it to the public sector. But we never had a proper steering of one health system. So South Africa has a very divided health system, and it's never been able to integrate that. And even under COVID, we still have this divide between public and private. It's a big problem. And we've really seen how that's been a problem under COVID, how communities have not been allowed to participate or do things that would help mitigate the effects of COVID. So a lot of community organizing, because ordinary people were kept out of decision-making when it came to COVID.
To actually realize how weak our health systems are, and actually to draw the paradigm between the support we get from the from the private sector and their support to the health systems, and how they run away from the health systems, you know, the public health systems, when it came to the COVID pandemic, you know? Because at the end of the day, the governments have, I think, realized that it is more important for them to invest in the health systems publicly, rather than using private players who actually ask for a lot of money and give you nothing at the end of the day. participation brings on board governments, because when you have no political will in anything in the sub-Saharan Africa, there's nothing you can do. But when you use the community voices, or you use participation for the communities to demand, or whoever is concerned with the challenge to demand, I think you have much better results. And that's why I have stuck by participation all this while. Yeah. And of course, thanks to learning from Professor Leslie, the models of participation, we have the PRA, we have the PER now.
And we know that governments often put in place systems of participation that are token. You know, they participation in form, but they're not participation in substance. And it's really important to make sure that it's participation in substance, that people can actually make decisions, that it's not just lip service, because we often see that. And we also know that communities often have knowledge that the health system doesn't have. So they can identify this, how to solve a problem where a health service doesn't know how to solve a problem, because the problem actually isn't a health service problem, it's a social determinants of health problem in the community. And the community know that, and they know what needs to be done. So we really want health systems that see communities as partners, as they're helping them solve health problems for better health outcomes. But we want them to understand that it's in their interest to have a strong community, because that community can help them get a post in their clinic, because then they can go to the district and say, I'm short-staffed, and this is the people need it. So there's a win-win there.
Remembering that many a time, the health workers were seen as gatekeepers of health and the means to health. So the community never really participated in health until we came in with this project in the areas where we worked, and tried to bring the two paradigms together, where you have the community with the health workers and then with some government political officials. And this really had an immense output for us. And I think Leslie really remember that when you'd hear the stories from both sides, you know, you see why participation is very important and key in the hemisphere of trying to bring together health. Yeah. So actually, the reason why we ended up partnering on this project was that we started out as a research, finding out why Uganda has very many good health policies. And then when you look at the health systems and the tiers of the health system that we have, because we have referral 1 to 7, they are very beautiful ideas. And then when you look at how the people at the grassroots are suffering because of the health injustices that are happening to them, you ask yourself why. It is a whole hullabaloo of reasons why. So the best way of us getting the root cause was to do the research. Fortunately, that's where Leslie came in. And you remember, Leslie, you brought the issue of us establishing models that could make it more participatory and probably give us more hands-on research and findings. So this research, then we now started to zone out which areas had the highest prevalence of challenges. And we ended up in a rural community in Uganda called Chiboga and Changwanzi. So while in these communities, you find that the hospitals are very far apart. So people have to walk long distances to access treatment or care. And then when we started rolling this out, we realized that the issue was that the people did not even know that they had the right to access this treatment. They had the right to get treatment by the government. They thought that if the government actually treats them, it is a privilege that the government has given.
You know, human rights are not just about the law, not just about going to court to win a case. It's about using human rights in a way positively, so that health workers can unite with communities, because we share the same objectives in that way. And that's what we try hard to work on, to try and use rights as a principle of a campaign, not just about fighting for a legal victory. I think the issue of getting community voice into policy platforms is really important, because that gives us the best chance to mainstream that sort of participation. Our countries have ratified the Convention on the Social, Economic, Cultural Rights. And each country is meant to do a submission about its progress on these rights. And, you know, shadow reporting was quite important for us in South Africa. And I think Uganda has also done that, where we've provided the Committee on Economic, Social and Cultural Rights with a different perspective. And that has enabled civil society participation. So we're aware that Brazil's health system is in serious trouble for many reasons. So a lot of those gains have been lost. But I think that's also an important way of thinking about how we could mainstream participation, because essentially power is where the money is. And if we can influence that for the better, that would be really strategic.
I think my very memorable moment in life was when we filed a case in court trying to fight for the rights of a husband who had lost the mother giving birth. So now that is not the memorable moment. The memorable moment was when the court threw us out on technicalities in the first instance. Yeah. But then when we went to the Supreme Court reinstated the suit, and the suit was heard. So the ruling coming out and the recommendations that the ruling had, yeah, about mothers dying while giving birth, and generally the health system, how it connects the right to life. I'm talking about our constitution, which does not necessarily have these sections of the right to life. My worst moment as an activist was when we went to do advocacy in one rural area and we were misunderstood by the politicians for misguiding the population, and they harassed us there because we were trying to bring people together to teach them about their right to life and right to health. And then it was around the political time and they thought we were trying to antagonize politically, and I think that was the most trying moment I had. And when I walked out of it, after it all had ended and we all understood each other that we are an NGO trying to do this to help the people here, I think for me, again, it made me realize why I am an activist and why I should stay doing activism all my life, regardless of whether we are paid or not.
We had a situation where the provincial health department was trying to push through a bill, a piece of law for how health committees, in other words, community participation, would fit in the law. And the health committees, people on the ground, were very unhappy. And basically, after investing a lot of effort in building their capacity and thinking about rights, they were able to independently go off to a meeting that the minister had set up in some rural area out of sight of the newspapers, and go and confront the minister over this bill and challenge her. And effectively, they've now kind of changed the way people see community participation in the Western Cape, in this province. And I think that was really an example where people were empowered and they were given the skills and understanding and tools, and they went out and they did it for themselves. So I think I was very proud about that. So we were involved in building capacity, and I think that's really important that you know, education is not just about information. It's about getting people to understand they have agency. They can change things around them. You know, the things that are bad around them, they can do it. They can change it. They just need the right information, the right understanding, know where to press the buttons, where to be politically active. We often assume that we know the right answers. Particularly if we are well-trained, you know, we are academics. But I think there's a lot of knowledge that we don't know that ordinary people have, and we can learn from ordinary people. And they have knowledge that is equally effective in different ways, and we need to combine those knowledges. And by combining those knowledges, we're much more effective. So, for instance, I work in research. I can bring the power of research into activism. But there are things which community organizers have, skills which they have, understandings of processes in communities which I don't have. And when you bring those two things together, they're very powerful. And you can bring them together for good, or you can bring them together for bad, because we see companies doing that, co-opting local elites to do things. So we need to harness as much as we can our potential, our strengths for good, you know, for equality, for equity, for health, for good outcomes.
If you want to be an activist, you must have a listening ear, because I think the biggest problem we have as activists, at least what I have seen I have, is that we want to talk too much and listen little. Because when you talk too much, there is no time to listen. So as an activist, you need to listen. Sometimes you don't have to speak because you must speak. Speaking last gives you the opportunity to have heard everyone else and compared what they are saying and be able to be the wise one to speak last. So the one thing I have learned is listen and listen and listen. Because when you don't listen, you get in trouble. And listening does not mean just listening. It also means read what others have written and be able to appreciate it. That way, when it happens, say you are in a context of a campaign where you want, for instance, to cause change, because you have listened to others and how they think, you can actually craft a very interesting message that will make them act immediately, and you get a quick win in a day. For instance, if I went to a mosque and I want Muslim people to start using family planning, I'm giving an example. I don't have to tell them, please use family planning. No, I have to define the message that, are you better off having to go to funerals, or are you better off having people in your mosque to pray with them? Did you know that the statistics show that you are having more death, you are attending more deaths, or you're praying for people who have passed on more than you are praying with them? And with such a kind of statistic, they will ask me to give my evidence. So already you see I have a platform because I have listened. I know that people are dying more than this. And the reason is that probably the population is overwhelming the system, something like that. So my learning and my advice is that listen more and speak less, although it is difficult for an activist.
Well, to all the communities that are still struggling and still achieving victories, yes to them.
I'm happy to see you, my old friend, Leslie, after a long time. And I'm happy that COVID has not run rampage on you. And please keep up the good work. I'm reading and seeing all the good work you're doing in South Africa. And we in Uganda are busy learning from you. And I know we lost our very good friend, Professor Sanders. But for us now who are learning from you people, I think are now seeing you as the person who has taken his place and teaching us what to do. Please remain the father of our advocacy. And it's good having you.
I hope you have a whole generation of new activists in Uganda and around the world.